thank you so much for that. I want to say a special welcome to Elizabeth and to Claire. Elizabeth is over there. Okay, Elizabeth is there. Claire, there. They're helping out with me. Yes, let's give one of these. Yeah, for their incredible work. Claire later will be guest directing or conducting. Elizabeth is playing in some fantastic music on the organ there, so thank you for sharing your talents with us. We sure appreciate it. All right, everybody, it is October 15th, 20th Sunday after Pentecost? Is that what that says? 20th? Wow, crazy. Time just goes by, doesn't it? So we're in the middle of October. Just a preview of what to expect the rest of the service. We're going to start our stewardship sermon series. Starts today. Everybody celebrate stewardship time. Yes, absolutely. Love it. A time where we can give generously and think about our generosity and remember the generosity that's been given to us and be good stewards of it. Sure appreciate that. All right, our liturgist for today. Who do I got on tap here today? It looks like Doug Crook. Doug, is Doug not here today? Uh-oh. All right, I'm going to need a guest fill-in for liturgist. Who wants to hop up? Come on up, Rita. Thank you so much. While Rita's coming up, where's Patty? Where'd Patty go? She did lit the candle. I wanted to ask her if she brought any barbecue home for me. Oh, no, she didn't. Oh, come on. She had a great trip over to Kansas City, right?
Yep. She did bring me a pair of Kansas City Chiefs slippers.
There you go. All right.
Okay, we all stand for the gathering words, please. Friends, we serve a God who designed us for humanity. We serve a God who doesn't ask us to go alone.
Come, let us sing together.
We're loved by a God who chooses to be with us.
Come, let us walk together.
Remain standing for our opening hymn.
Scripture now? Yeah, great. All right, here you go. Nope, go for it.
The scripture this morning is taken from Acts 2, verses 14 through 18. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, Let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be. God declares that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams, even upon my slaves, both men and women. In those days, I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy.
All right. At this time, we will open up the floor for the sharing of joys and concerns. If you have either one of those, please raise your hand, and Lisa will come around with the microphone here in the sanctuary. Once you have the mic, please state your name and then share whatever you're comfortable sharing. If you're joining us online, of course, please also add those in the comment section, and we'll make sure to, even if we don't capture them in real time, we'll for sure write them down and get them to our prayer teams at either church. So please share your joys and concerns online as well.
Liz Chavez, two joys today. It's our daughter's 56th birthday. And she was with us this weekend, which was very cool. And we have a person joining us this morning from our childhood, those of us who've been here a while. Bobby Johnson is by Patty, and he's the Johnson family, longtime Methodist.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you for being here. Thank you.
Jim Stutzman, Joyce, thank you all for your prayers and cards following my surgery. And a big thanks to my wife, who has stepped back into her nurse days and taken care of me.
Thank you.
And another joy, Claire, our granddaughter, is going to be directing later today.
Yeah, very cool. Thank you.
Rick Towsley, I have a concern for the situation that's happening in the Gaza Strip right now. I mean, we need a lot of prayers for that area. There's a lot of sadness going on both sides.
I'll ask for prayers for Travel Mercies. I'm going to Baker City, Oregon today to take my mom to the doctor tomorrow and hope to get her back on some of her medications that my dad took her off of. And then also, I have a praise that as of Friday, I am back to managing only one store.
So. Congratulations. Patty Mills, and I thank you all for Travel Mercies. Successful trip. Worst part was coming back home at Orfino, and my brakes work great. But otherwise, it was a wonderful trip. Thank you for your prayers.
Yeah, I'm glad you're home. I'm glad you had a great trip, too.
My name is Mary, and I want to ask for prayers for my niece Jean, who is flying into Spokane tomorrow from Iowa.
Did you say Jean?
Jean.
Pat Heimgartner, we need continued prayers for Lois Chestnut and Mary McNish.
If you would please join me in a pastoral prayer and then all together for the Lord's Prayer. God, we come together. We are grateful for community, for family, that we can join together, that we share these joys and these concerns, these burdens and these celebrations all together. We are a mix of all these things, and thankfully, we do not need to do any of this alone. You've gifted us with an incredible community, a congregation, support. We're there for each other for the good and the bad. And Lord, we lift up to you these concerns that have been named. We do pray, continue to pray fervently for Mary and for Lois and their health. Lord, we pray for recovery for both of them. We do pray for safety in all that's still lying ahead for them both. Lord, just wrap them with your love, with your grace. And Lord, a gift, we're thankful for the gift of hospitals and doctors and nurses and support staff who are so good and so caring. And just pray that they would be attentive and full of care and compassion for Mary and for Lois. Lord, we're so grateful with what Jim has shared for the surgery, successful surgery, recovery going well so far. So good to see him here singing, and we're grateful for the support that he's had from folks here in the church, and also, of course, from his beautiful bride, and her nursing abilities have really come into play again, and we're just so grateful for that. Lord, we're grateful for Bob Johnson being here. Great to see him. We're grateful for Liz's daughter visiting as well, celebrating 56th birthday, but also visiting, I think, as she mentioned, and we're just grateful for celebrations like that. And Lord, lift up Lisa to you for travel coming up today, for the doctor's visit with her mom tomorrow. Pray that all the categories would be checked and all the medicines would be lined up, that Dee would have a better quality of life through the help of different for medicine and through support. And we pray for the trip home as well. Grateful for the reduction in role down to manager of just one store right now. It means a lot for time, for health and travel and all that good stuff. Lord, we lift up Mary's niece to you as she'll be traveling and flying into Spokane. Just pray for safe journey, safe weather, good weather, safe landing, and a good return home as well. And so wonderful to see Patty. God, we're thankful for the travel that she had, that it was a success, made it home with no problems, and probably real uplifting for the spirit, for encouragement and all that. We're just grateful that she is here, though. And Lord, we, with so many people around the world, we join our prayers for the situation in Gaza, for the conflict, for the innocents lost all around. Always the innocent who don't have anything to do with anything going on that get impacted the most. We pray for children, for women, for innocent bystanders on the Israeli side and on the Palestinian side that certainly did not ask for any of this. God, we just pray for a peaceful resolution, quick, peaceful resolution, that no more harm would be done. It's just going to take creative thinking. It's going to take wisdom beyond what we probably collectively have. And so we reach out to you, God, for miracles, for insight, for inspiration, and that it would happen quickly. Come, Lord, quickly come. God, lots of other things, I'm sure, maybe in the comments section I didn't get to see, or perhaps I forgot to write down, anything like that. We lift that up to you, God, and we pray for your guidance. We pray for your wisdom. We're thankful for your grace and your mercy, abundant in all of our lives. And now, God, we come together as one voice to offer up the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. That was awesome. Okay. So good morning, everybody. Is it still morning? I don't know. Is it? Yes, still technically. We're still in the AM, so it's still morning. All right, so we are, as I mentioned, we are beginning our series on stewardship. It's fall time, so we're going to talk a little bit about, you know, being good stewards of the gifts that we've been given. And yes, of course, that includes finances. We're going to talk about that, of course. But it also involves our relationships. It involves our abilities, our talents, our time, and other resources. All of that is what we mean when we talk about stewardship. How are we being good stewards or bad stewards of all of those things that God has given to us? And so I want to begin with a theme or an idea that is going to have overarching implications for the whole series. And that's based on a quote from Aristotle, all right? And you've probably heard this before, I'm sure. The quote is, "The whole is greater than the sum of its parts." You've heard that before, I'm sure. The idea being that when you bring together, whatever it might be, multiple people, multiple gifts, multiple resources, that the sum of the parts, when it's added all together, it actually gets multiplied. The effort, the time, the money, all of those things. And we're going to do much more rather together than just alone. And so we're going to focus on this idea and this theme throughout this exploration of stewardship, because one aspect of growing as a disciple, a follower of Christ, and we've been talking about this all year, what it means to be a disciple, to make disciples, and part of it is being committed to responding to God's generosity by being generous yourself. Abundant living, we might call it, but it's about aligning our priorities with God's priorities, aligning our hearts with God's heart. I think we grow in generosity and as a part of a healthy spirituality. If you are in a healthy relationship with God and with others, your generosity grows and grows and grows. And that is true for individuals. And it's also true for communities or groups together. Now, the book of Acts is where we're going to start. I wanted to highlight these disciples in the book of Acts and their lives and the power of community that they found, that they realized together that they could have if they continue to grow in discipleship. And I just want to say that together is greater than alone. Do you believe that? Generosity is greater than holding back. Do you believe that? Thriving is greater than surviving. Do you believe that? I believe that too. What can we do to thrive rather than just survive? And so this whole series is going to be called Greater Than. And we're going to look at some things that are greater than. And we're going to begin today with the we is greater than me. And I want to begin by reading the rest of the story. So Rita read from Acts chapter 2, a familiar little passage of scripture when the folks were gathered together in Jerusalem and the Holy Spirit descended on the people and the church was born that day. And here's what ended up happening later on in the story from Acts chapter 2. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and their goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent time together in the temple and breaking bread at home together, they ate their food with glad and generous hearts together, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. That's the end of the chapter, Acts chapter 2, from where the story Rita was reading comes from. Now, I want to kick off this particular sermon, we is greater than me, with this little statement, and you can write it down if you have a pen, if you want to take this note. You've heard this before. This is not, I'm not creating this idea. You've probably heard this before, but it's an old, timely bit of wisdom that says, If you want to go quickly, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. All right? I'll say it again. If you want to go quickly, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Okay, with that in mind, I need to make a confession to you. All right? Now, you all know that I was gone in the month of September. I was at home with my hometown, with my mom and my dad. My mom was, it was kind of an emergency situation. She was being moved to hospice care. It didn't look good, especially when I first got there. And there, just a couple days after arrival, it looked like, the, you know, this could be it. This could be the end. And so we were there. That had all of my focus, all of my attention, all my energy, all my time was on that. I'm telling you that because when I got home from that month, being there for my mom, and she rallied, and she's doing pretty darn well, all things considered, is still on hospice care, but energy seems to be pretty good, and some hopefulness for at least a trip, maybe to Boise to be there, just to see how that goes, to see how travel goes being on hospice care. So we'll see how that goes. But when I got home at the end of September, the week that I got home, I got basically Tuesday is when I got home, I was reminded that on Saturday of that week, there was a fundraiser fun run that I had helped sign up all of the Methodist churches in the valley to support and be a part of, all right, for the Tri-State Memorial Hospital Foundation, okay? And it involved money, it was fine, that's no worries there, but it also included, for the money, you got your, we got Methodist logos and information put on shirts, posters, advertisement mentioned on online advertising and radio advertising, Facebook posts, social media posts, website for the Tri-State Memorial Foundation, all good, but we also got a booth at the fundraiser that I was reminded we could go be part of. I was reminded on Wednesday. So I figured there's just not enough time to get anybody to go do this from any of the four churches. I'll just go do it myself. All right? And you had to get up early on Saturday morning to go and get your spot and set it up. And as I was, I was already worn out from just the whole month of energy and focus. Saturday morning, I wasn't doing great, but I got up. I went out to the garage to get a pop-up canopy and some tables. And as many of you know, I am wrestling with nerve damage that causes vertigo. And the vertigo is worse when I'm tired and burnt out and not doing well on that. So in the middle of the dark on Saturday morning, I'm trying to get a canopy, a table, some chairs, cooler, and I am falling all over the place. And so finally, it was such a struggle that I was like, I'm going to call the guy and I'm going to say, I'm sorry, we can't be there. And he said, actually, that's fine. Most of our sponsors actually don't put a booth in. They just do everything else, the t-shirts, the posters, all that stuff. So you're all in on all of that. Maybe next year. And so I learned a lesson that day about the necessity of not doing things alone. That, you know, you can get a lot farther by going together with people rather than trying to tackle it on your own. It was not going to happen. Now, most of us have stories probably just like that, where in our lives we have decided for whatever reason, right? Okay, there's this project that's coming up. I know it needs to get done. It is not going to get done the way I want it to get done if other people do it. So I'm going to do it all on my own. You ever done that? Ever been guilty of saying that before? Now, if anyone is brave enough to share what ended up happening or what has happened in those instances, anyone want to share a little bit what maybe has happened? What? I hear a little, what's that? And maybe it didn't even get done at all. Or actually in the Clarkson Church, somebody was brave enough to say, yes, I am a perfectionist. And so I wrestle with this all the time, and I always have this idea in my head of how it's going to be, and I know if other people help, it's not going to be the way I picture it. But 9 times out of 10, the end result itself doesn't end up looking like I wanted it to look like anyway, because I'm stressed, hurried, rushed. I've got too many other things going on, and so I might as well have asked for help anyway, because it was never going to end up the way I had it pictured in my head as a perfectionist. So I needed the help, and it goes much farther. Most of us have stories just like that. I'm sure we can all think of times when something was easier or more successful when we worked together rather than alone. In the history of this church, I can guarantee you have stories of this, of things that have happened because of this church working together as one. Some incredible things have happened. You know what, actually, even just in this last year alone, you know, there are we've been a part of a few different events. We did a 4th of July celebration. We did a Santa Claus or a winter kind of gathering. We did an Easter egg hunt, all of which were very successful because several people pitched in and helped out. If one person had done it on their own, there's no way that 200 eggs could have been filled, you know, for the Easter event. There's no way that cookies that needed to be baked and set out for our Christmas event, no way that that could have been done. There's no way that hot dogs, games, cornhole, chairs, music could have been set up and ready to go for the 4th of July if just one person tried to do it all. But many hands make light work, they say, and it has been proven true over and over and over again. And so you have this in your DNA. This is a part of the Methodist tradition, not just in this church, but dating back to the very beginning. The roots and foundation of the Wesleyan movement was all about, at the heart of it all, groups. They were called classes, they were called orders, and they were units of, the smallest unit was 5 people, up to classes, which were a unit of 12, and then up to societies, which were basically churches, you know, essentially like that. But these groups were the heartbeat of a movement that grew and changed the world. People who were impoverished were fed and taken care of. Hospitals were built where hospitals were needed. Children who had been abandoned by families were being taken in and taken care of, all because groups of individuals said, together, we can do a lot. I think we can take care of some of these problems. And so, in the passage of Scripture today that I had Rita read, just to give you a little tiny bit of background so you understand what's happening in this moment, it is in Jerusalem. The disciples are gathered there. Jesus has ascended and left. The disciples are kind of gathered together, wondering what in the world are we supposed to do next. And in Jerusalem were gathered thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands, possibly, of people gathered in Jerusalem for a festival called Sukkot, or the Festival of Booths, or the Festival of Weeks. In Greek, Pentecost is what it's called. And it's so called because it's 50 days or 7 weeks after, in the Christian tradition, after Easter, in the Jewish tradition, after Passover. 7 weeks after Passover, gathered together, bringing with them their first harvest, parts of their first harvest to offer at this festival. Now, at this festival, another celebration was added over time, and it was the celebration of the Ten Commandments coming down from Mount Sinai, given to the people. And if you remember that story, there were the Hebrew nation was gathered at Mount Sinai, and on top of the mountain was thunder and lightning and fire and wind, and Moses came down twice with the Ten Commandments because the first time didn't go so well, you know? So he brought them down twice, and they celebrate and commemorate that day because that was the birth of their country, their nation, their people. Here's an interesting little tidbit that not a lot of people think about or know. That gathering of people at Mount Sinai weren't all Hebrew people. It was literally every slave set free from Egypt. When they left, they brought with them the Hebrew word, and I can't remember it off the top of my head, but it's literally a diverse rabble is what it's called, is what in Hebrew the word is translated. It wasn't just Hebrew people. It was literally every servant and slave from every nation that Egypt had taken. They just said, all of y'all, get out. Go. And so at this mountain, you have this diverse rabble of people that God has said, I'm calling you together to be a nation. We is greater than me. You all together are a nation, this diverse group. So fast forward to this moment that Rita read about, you have a diverse rabble of people gathered in Jerusalem from every known language at the time that was close by that could travel. That's why they listed there's a list, a good list, a motley crew of people from all over the world gathered into Jerusalem for this festival. And in that moment, there's fire and wind and the voice of God. And Peter comes out and says, hey, I have some crazy ideas. The Holy Spirit is here, and the Holy Spirit's going to draw all together all people to create a new people, a new movement. And that's why he reads from the book of Joel and says that the Holy Spirit is going to descend on all people, young, old, male, female, even the servants and slaves, all together. You are called to be God's people because the we is greater than the me. What we can do together is greater than what we can do alone. And that day, the church was born. And I read to you what went on to happen when a group of people who said, we are better together than we are separate, they started to change the world in that moment. And here we are today because of it. Today. And you've heard me say this year more than once, what God did then, God does now. Friends, I'm looking out at you all, and you are a diverse rabble of people. All right? There's quite the motley mix here. And that's just in our congregation. Most of you know, we are having conversations about all the churches in the valley. And we are a diverse group of people with lots of different backgrounds, but we are starting to have this idea that what we can do together is better and more, greater than what we can do apart from each other. So, last week, it was like 85, 90 people gathered together to worship over at the Clarkson Church. Wasn't it awesome? It was great. But I couldn't also help but think about, gosh, 85 people together to worship. But what if we also had a crazy dream and vision together of something we could do in this valley? What if 80, and I'm just picking something at random. I did it over at Clarkson too, just something random. What if 80 people, Methodists who care about things like poverty, education, healthcare. We care about those things, right? What if 80 people who cared about those things said, we want to tackle childhood literacy in the Valley? We want to help young kids grow in love with reading and learning. What if 80 people said we could do that together? What kind of difference would there be in the Valley for kids? I can tell you, I can give you a taste of the difference. So over at Clarkston, at the Parkway Elementary where my kids go, there's a library, and in the library there's a whole section of the library, a nice little nook called the Marjorie Ferguson Reading Corner. You might not know who Marjorie Ferguson is. Marjorie Ferguson was a member of the Clarkston United Methodist Church, and she loved reading to kids. She couldn't do a whole lot of other things, but she read with joy and passion with children. And so she, every week, went and read over at Parkway Elementary. She passed away in 2012 or 13. When I walk into that school today, 10 years later, do you know that there are teachers there and administrators who, when you say, I know about Marjorie, they go, you will not believe the impact that woman had on people, on students. Reading comprehension skyrocketed when she was there. And all she did was just read to the kids, but she did it with joy and passion. She loved it. She loved being with the kids, and the kids knew it, could tell it, and it fostered in them a love for learning and reading. It was incredible. It's incredible to hear their story. And that's all she did. She just went and read with passion and creativity. She just loved doing it. And it has, 10 years later, they're still talking about it. Now imagine if 80 people said, hey, I could go read at McSorley Elementary one day a week for 30 minutes. What if 80 people did that at every elementary in the Valley? I wonder what could happen. Now, I want you to notice, Peter had to tell everybody, I'm not drunk, okay? I'm just filled with an incredible vision and an incredible dream. Friends, if people don't hear our dreams and visions and go, are you crazy? Have you had a little too much to drink? If they don't hear that, we aren't dreaming big enough if people don't think we're crazy. So I want to encourage you to get crazy. I want you to come up with big dreams and visions. Now, I don't know. Let's push pause a little bit because I want to state something. I've heard the last 2 weeks, I have heard from so many different people what we are planning to do as, you know, as a merger, as a potential merger. And I'm always surprised because I'm like, gosh, I didn't even know we talked about that. I didn't even know we made those plans. I've got to tell you right now, you all, if you're hearing things, go, hang on. Because all that we've decided is literally this. This is the only thing that's been decided. We should talk about it. That's it. So if you're hearing people say, we're going to be at this church, that church, or we're going to meet at this time with these things, or we're going to close all these buildings and we're going to build something over here, go, no. Sorry, I don't know what you've heard. We're just talking about it right now. That's it. That's the only thing we've done. And so I'm telling you this because I want you to know, no matter what it looks like in a year or two, what matters is this. We is greater than me. So even if we don't merge as four churches, don't you think, though, that 80 people together tackling something, united as United Methodists in this valley, something incredible could happen? I think so. So no matter what happens, my heart is that we begin to work together because we is greater than me and we can do incredible things together. The whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Do you agree? So I want you guys to practice a little bit. I challenged Clarkston to do this. They collect food for the Asotin County Food Bank, and Terry keeps track of the weight. So she knows how much we donated last year. I'm challenging the Clarkston Church to take that number, whatever it was from last year, and go 50% more. Now look, see, that's the faces I got over there. And I said, you think I'm drunk right now, don't you? Amen, good. Because that means it's a big enough dream and vision. We can do it. So I don't know what the challenge is going to be here. What should we do here? Do you guys want to do a food bank challenge? What do you want to do? What if, okay, what if here, this church, let's say at, since I talked about reading, what if I can get in the next year 10 of you to volunteer to read over at, let's say, McSorley Elementary School? Do you think that's a crazy enough dream? You think I'm, or do I need to dream bigger? Bigger? 12 people? 15 people? Are you, have you had too much to drink over there? Yes? Okay. 15 people. Let's do it. 15 people to volunteer to read over at McSorley. Challenge out there. Let me know if you accept, okay? Now, let's pray, because I've gone on way too long. God, I lift up to you this community here. Lord, I pray that we would be of one heart, one mind, that we would understand and know that we is greater than me. We are limited people. We have weaknesses. We have flaws. We don't have enough time just on our own, enough resources. But put us together, we could do something incredible. More importantly, we have the power of the Holy Spirit that draws us and binds us together. So God, I pray that we would be moved to do something big together. Give us the humility to reach out and ask for help, and give us the availability to respond when we're asked for help too. We love you, God, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. At this time, I believe we're going to play an offertory. Yes. Thank you. All right, let me just real quick let folks who are joining online know how you can participate in giving. First of all, you can mail checks. There's the addresses to either church. You can drop them off at the office. Just call ahead and make sure somebody's in the office before you do. You can participate in online giving. So the Clarkston Church has a big green button over there on the right-hand side. Just click that, and it'll take you to a spot to give. For Lewiston, it's the contact us menu, you drop that down and there's a donate button right there. And then both churches have mobile apps as well. So for Clarkson, it's the Tithely app, T-I-T-H-E.ly. Download that, search for Clarkson UMC, and you can give that way. For Lewiston, it's the Vanco mobile app, and search for the First United Methodist Church in Lewiston, Idaho. And let's see, right-hand fun, yeah, sure. We were all in one place over there, so you probably already have given to the right-hand fund if you did, but just so you're aware, the right-hand fund is a pastoral discretionary fund that I use to help folks with travel concerns, rental assistance, groceries if they're needing some, especially if they've got children, or if they need a hotel stay because maybe it's unsafe at their home, stuff like that. That's what I use that for. So if you have any extra you want to give, that's a one way you can have a direct impact in the life of somebody going through a crisis type situation. So you can write a check and just make it out, put in the memo right hand fund, and it'll get to the right spot. All right, let me say a prayer for the offering. God, we thank you so much for these gifts. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We pray that this offering would be blessed, that it would multiply tenfold and be used to help others also become disciples of love and grace and truth. We love you, God, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Just a few announcements real quickly before a choral benediction. So, Fellowship Hall, Fridays, 9:30 a.m., coffee and contemplation. Join, I think they were talking about the Gaza situation last time. So, you know, they don't shy away from the hot button topics. They are full bore. They will talk about them all. What's the topic this Friday? Probably more of that. Yeah. It's a thorny issue. Also, the book group. So we are actually done with the book, Braiding Sweetgrass. Great book. We're ready to pick a new one. So if you want to join us on Friday after that discussion time at 11 a.m. at the Fellowship Hall here, bring a book suggestion. We've kind of narrowed it down to three, but we'll let you bring a suggestion if you have one for us and let us know. We will entertain all possibilities, right? We're open to anything. But join us for that. We'd sure love to have you. And it looks like maybe we've got something, an announcement over here we need to make. Okay, what do you got?
We have the trick or trunk.
Trick or trunk coming up.
We would like to know ahead of time if you plan on doing the trick or trunk so we know about how many to plan on. It is on Halloween night starting at 5.
5 o'clock.
It has an ending at 6, but it probably will go longer because we have games in the yard and then you're handing out candy.
Yes.
So all you need to do is hand out candy. Most people decorate their trunk. If you would like your trunk decorated and don't have that ability, if you let Kyle and I know, Kyle and I and Kathleen will help decorate trunks.
They have car trunk kits for you to decorate. So we could use as many trunks as possible to hand out candy. So please come join us. Remember, we greater than me. Otherwise, it'll just be me out there with my van handing out candy, and that never looks good, a one man handing out candy from a van, you know, it just doesn't look good. All right, so come help us out with your love on the help on Halloween for Trunk or Treat. Oh, one more thing.
If anybody would like to send Lois Chestnut a card and it does not have one, I have some cards. I don't know why we have so many, but in my household we have a lot of thanking of you cards and goodwill cards. If you'd like to sign one, we're sending them all up, and I have a ton of stamps that have never been used.
Nice.
I don't mail anything anymore.
Okay, so
if you'd like to come out in the Fellowship Hall, I have them out there.
Fellowship Hall cards to send to Lois Chestnut. She sure would appreciate that. All right. Can I do a benediction and then you, or do you want me to wait and do mine?
Let's do ours first.
Perfect. Okay. Let's hear it. Well, it's going to be great. I send you off with a benediction. This week, may you know in your heart that we is greater than me. May you know that you have the power of the Holy Spirit to do incredible things. And if you do them together, that power gets multiplied. Peace be with you.